మార్నింగ్ స్టూడెంట్స్, వెల్కమ్ బ్యాక్ టు అవర్ నెక్స్ట్ క్లాస్. టుడేస్ క్లాస్ ఐ విల్ స్టార్ట్ అవర్ నెక్స్ట్ టాపిక్, రిప్రజెంటేషన్ ఆఫ్ ఫంక్షనల్స్ ఆన్ హిల్బర్ట్ స్పేస్. ఇన్ దిస్ టాపిక్ ఫస్ట్ యూ ఆర్ హ్యావింగ్ ద డెఫినేషన్స్, లేటర్ థియరీస్. ఓకే, సీ ద టాపిక్ నేమ్, రిప్రజెంటేషన్ ఆఫ్ ఫంక్షనల్స్ on Hilbert spaces. On Hilbert spaces. Okay? First I would like to explain the definitions. Definitions. The first definition is linear functional. First definition is linear functional. So one linear map is said to be linear functional if satisfies one condition. See the definition. A linear map denoted with F from X to K, domain to codomain, is said to be linear functional. Is said to be linear functional if satisfies the condition f of ax plus by is equal to a into f of x plus b into f of y. So if it satisfies the condition f of ax plus by is equal to a into f of x plus b into f of y, then the linear map f is called linear functional. Next definition, bounded linear functional. Next definition is bounded linear functional. We already know the bounded condition. Either a function or functional is said to be bounded if condition is norm of the function is less than or equal to particular constant, either c or k or something. If you are taking any variable on both sides, f of x is less than or equal to certain constant into x, then this function is called bounded. Here also same thing. A linear functional is said to be bounded if there exists a constant c greater than 0 such that the norm of f of x is less than or equal to c into norm x, whether k into norm x. Okay? See the definition. A linear functional, already it is linear functional, satisfies only bounded property. A linear functional f from x to k. Okay? F from x to k is said to be bounded, already linear function. So is said to be bounded if there exists c greater than 0 such that the norm of f of x is less than or equal to this k into norm x for all small x belongs to capital X, then call it as bounded linear function. Let it be equation number 1. After that, we are writing the norm f formula. You already know norm of an operator T, same formula. Here also we are writing, that is our next line. Therefore, norm F is equal to supremum of, therefore, norm F is equal to supremum of over X. belongs to capital X and X non-zero, you already know this formula, X non-zero. Then modulus of f of x by norm x, okay? Modulus of f of x by norm x. Okay, copy the rules from the videos. Okay, now later I would like to explain results on the note points. Okay, so results and these note points are useful for our next theorems. So here results is nothing but the known theorem statements. Okay, now so first known point. In this known point, x dash is equal to next line note. X dash is equal to set of all functions f such that f from x to k is bounded comma linear. Mean to say these functions are bounded linear, then all the functions are is in the x dash, then x dash is called the real space of x, then x dash is called dual space of x. Real space of x. This is the right point. Next result. Here you are having the two results. First result. Result one. Known theorem only. This is if Y is a closed subspace of Hilbert space H. Hilbert space H. Then full stop. Then H is equal to Y orthogonal. H is equal to Y direct sum Z comma Z is where Z is equal to Y orthogonal complement. This is the direct sum theorem statement. You already know and having the proof also in the previous topic. Okay. Next result two. Okay. Result two. This result two also theorem statement only. If t from x to y be a linear operator. If t from x to y is a linear operator, then n of t is closed subspace of x, then n of t is closed subspace of x. So these two results are known theorem statements. You already have the proofs in previous topics. Okay. So after this, I will explain first theorem, Ries theorem. Ries apostrophe S theorem. So in this theorem, the statement is every bounded linear functional on a Hilbert space H can be represented in terms of inner product, namely f of x is equal to inner product x comma z for all x belongs to H, where z depends on f
is uniquely determined by F and has the norm F is equal to norm Z. Very important theorem for long answer.
See the statement. In terms of inner product, f of x is equal to inner product x comma z, where small z is depends upon the f, is unique, mean to say we want to show that this z is unique, determined by f and has the norm f is equal to norm z. So this is our aim in this theorem. So first we are taking bounded linear functional f. F on Hilbert space H. Later we want to show that the f of x in terms of the inner product. This is the first one. Second one is Z is unique. And the third one is norm F is equal to norm Z. This is our aim in this theme. So now we will show these conditions in the two cases. This functional F is equal to 0, then these conditions are exist or not. Second one, when F is non-zero, we will show the conditions. Okay? See the problem. First of all, we are taking one bounded linear functional on the Hilbert space H. So, proof, let the small F be a bounded linear functional on Hilbert space H. Okay. Later we can show that this F is represented in terms of the inner product. Second one is Z is unique. Third one is norm F is equal to norm Z. These three conditions, first we will show in the case 1, that case 1 is if f is equal to 0. Next line, then take z is also 0 because z is defined on the, depends on the f. F 0, so automatically we are taking z value is also 0. Under the condition, f of x is equal to inner product x comma z is also true. Mean to say f 0, so that f is 0. In the inner product one variable is 0, inner product total becomes 0. So that this one is also goes to 0. And norm f is also equal to norm z. So we got our required two conditions in the case 1, that is f is equal to 0. Clear? Here nothing to show. When f is 0, z is depends upon the f, so that take z is also 0. Then the condition f of x is equal to inner product x comma z satisfies and norm f is equal to norm of z. In the case 2, when f is non-zero, we will show the conditions. Now, second case. If f not equal to 0, then z also non-zero. If z is 0, what will happen? We will check in the next line. Then we will get the confirmation when f non-zero, automatically z is also non-zero. See the next line. If z is equal to 0, then what will happen? Inner product of x comma z goes to 0. Then inner product of x comma z is equal to 0. So this entire thing is nothing but f of x is equal to 0. Nothing but f is equal to 0. Is it clear? Our case is f not 0. But when z is equal to 0, what we got? F 0. Mean to say, when f not 0, z is also non 0. So next line is, thus z cannot be 0. No chance for z is equal to 0. Next, one more line, which is not true. Which is not true. So in our case, f non-zero, but we got f 0, which is not correct. Not correct, we will say z cannot be 0. Next line. N, therefore, n of f is equal to, what is the n of f value? Null space. We know that null space definition, set of all x belongs to the H after satisfying the condition, this operator into variable is equal to 0, null and no value, so that value goes to 0. Null of f, n space of f, n of f is equal to x belongs to h such that f of x is equal to 0. Next line, by the result, second point, by the result second point, t be a linear operator, then n of t is closed subspace of x. Same thing, n of f, here f is a linear operator, so that n of f m is from that known statement, closed subspace of H. So next line, then n of f is closed subspace of Hilbert space H. By applying the known theorem, state. Okay. See the continuation. So N of F is closed subspace of Hilbert space H. Then by the known theorem, Z is orthogonal to x for all x belongs to n of f. So in our next line, this x is replaced with the set n of f. Next, we are using again the known since part. Since n of null space n of f is set up on bounded linear operator, linear functionals, and it is closed, so that as f non-zero, we know it. We have n of f not equal to h. Next, we are applying orthogonal complement on both sides. Then, n of f orthogonal complement is not equal to h orthogonal complement. H orthogonal complement is singleton zero. So, that n of f orthogonal complement not equal to singleton zero. Also, n of f orthogonal complement not equal to 0 means to say it is having the non-zero element. So our next line is, then there exists a non-zero element say z naught in n of f orthogonal complement. See the next line. So now n of f not equal to 0 means to say, next line is, then there exists a non-zero element. We are taking that element is the z naught in the n of f orthogonal complement. So next, we are taking v is equal to f of x into z naught minus, let v is equal to f of x into z naught minus f of x naught into z. We are getting f of x into z naught minus f of z naught into x. Sorry ma, f of z naught into x comma where x belongs to h is arbitrary element. Where x belongs to h is arbitrary element. Okay, next we have to calculate f of b naught. Then f of b is equal to small b ma, f of substitute b value, f of x into z naught minus f of z naught into x. Okay, allow the simplifications ma, f of x into f of z naught minus f of z naught into for this x f of x. Okay, so f of z naught into f of x minus f of z naught into f of x, so that cancel the both the terms, so what is the value? 0. So f of b is equal to 0, nothing but the function of variable is equal to 0 means to say that variable belongs to null space, so b belongs to null space of f, L of f. Next slide, we know from this z naught also belongs to L of f orthogonal complement. Mean to say this z naught element is orthogonal to L of f. This meaning is this thing, z naught is orthogonal to L of f. So in the L of f, what is the variable to be? Mean to say this z naught is orthogonal to b. Okay, see our next slide now. So next slide is, therefore z naught is orthogonal to n of f. N of f element is the b, so b. So orthogonality meaning is inner product of the two element value goes to 0. Okay, so write the next slide. Therefore inner product of z naught comma b is equal to 0. Orthogonality definition. Next slide. But inner product of b comma z naught is equal to, we have to calculate the value. But inner product of b z, b comma z naught value, we have to calculate. Okay, substitute b value. Inner product of v is nothing but f of x into z naught minus f of z naught into x comma z naught. Okay, here we have to write the inner product separately. Then see, f of x is the function as it is. Inner product of the variable z naught comma z naught, inner product of z naught comma z naught minus function is f of z naught. Inner product is x comma z naught. Okay, next line, f of x into inner product of z naught comma z naught is norm z naught square minus f of z naught into inner product of x comma z naught. No, x comma z naught. Now from the above line, z naught inner product of z naught comma b is equal to 0, so that the L substitute the value in the LHS 0. Next, we have to send the negative term to that side, to LHS, then f of x into norm z naught square is equal to f of z naught into inner product of x comma z naught. From this we have to calculate f of x value. What is the f of x? Is equal to f of z naught into inner product of x comma z naught by f of by norm z naught square.
Say by doing the simplifications will get our required condition. See the next line, ma.
Our next line is after the f of x. First we are taking the z value, right? Z is equal to f of z naught whole bar into z naught by norm z naught square. See this is in part, ma. Can you understand this? This term, all this is the term we are taking, f of z naught into inner product of x comma z naught by norm z naught square. Now we can send this term, this part, into the inner product, then inner product of x comma, sending to the second term, it is automatically bar existed f bar of z naught into z naught by bar z naught square. This entire thing we already took, it is z. So now this entire value we substitute it in the above line, then what we got, f of x is equal to inner product of x comma z. This is our required first point in this second case. Next, to show that z is unique, next line, to show that z is unique. So for this uniqueness, here we are taking f of x is equal to inner product of x comma z, and f of x is equal to inner product of x comma z1. Two variables we are taking, z1. Finally we have to show that the two variables are equal. So next line, if possible, suppose f of x is equal to inner product of x comma z, and f of x is equal to inner product of x comma z1. If you are showing z is equal to z1, then z is unique. Now if you are observing these two terms, LHS is same, so that RHS is also equal. See the next line, then equal the LHS. This box part only for your understanding purpose, ma. Okay, na? Our next line is, so here LHS equal, so that RHS also equal. Then inner product of x comma z is equal to inner product of x comma z1. Now we can send RHS to LHS and equal to 0. So x comma z minus inner product of x comma z1 is equal to 0. It can be written as inner product of x comma z minus z1 is equal to 0 for all x belongs to h. Now we are taking z minus z1 is equal to x, then what will happen? Next slide. Let z minus z1 is equal to x, then replace this variable with this inner product x comma x goes to 0. Now inner product of x comma x goes to 0 equals a norm x square 0. Next is n plus square, taking the norm, and what will get? X is equal to 0.
When f is non-zero. For this next line, now we have modulus of f of x is less than modulus of f of x is equal to this thing. Now we have modulus of f of x is equal to
modulus of f of x is nothing but inner product of x comma z. Again, by the square chain inequality, which is less than or equal to norm x into norm z, which is less than or equal to norm x into norm z. Next line, therefore, norm f is equal to, we have to write the formula, therefore, we have to write norm f formula, that is equal to supremum of modulus of f of x, where x belongs to capital X and the norm x value is equal to 1. You are having the norm 2 formulas, we are using the second formula. Now, in place of modulus of f of x, we have to substitute this value, then automatically it will changes to less than or equal to supremum of norm x into norm z, where x belongs to capital X and norm x is equal to 1. Once you are substituting norm x value 1, but supremum is based on the small x, then it becomes only norm z. So what we got here, norm f is less than or equal to norm z, then it be equation number 2. Finally, our conclusion is norm from 1 and 2 both are equal. So next line, from 1 and 2, equation 1 and 2, norm f is equal to norm z. Hence, totally 3 cases in this theorem. Three cases we show. Okay? With the next theorems, we will discuss in the next class.